morning, Brighton. My name is Stefania. I come from Romania. I'm based in Berlin. And today I'm going to try to take you on a journey of making in the heart of crafts and exploration in Africa. So this is how we see Africa from our continent. This is a view of Africa from the Rock of Gibraltar. And I was there in the beginning of this year. The idea was to run a project called AfriMakers, where we would work with local makers from 10 countries around Africa and enable them to solve their own problems with rapid prototyping and with crafting. So we started our journey in Alexandria, Egypt. And it was wonderful because I met a lot of young people that were part of a self-organized community called Ice Alex. And we start discovering how to prototype and how to build things. We had a kit for that. So in our kit, we had sensors, boards, conducting foil, soldering irons, all sorts of tools just to kind of get started. But the big idea was to build something that is meaningful for the local community in Egypt. So one of the projects that was born in Alexandria was an air pollution monitoring station, because they have a lot of air pollution there. It was very affordable. It was only 30 euros. And the good thing is that the mentors, after they learned, they went and they taught kids in schools how to build this type of prototypes, and also how to think about the future of the city, of the future of their country, and how they can solve their own problems. The best part of this journey of making is that the people that were trained would become the new trainers. So the most proactive mentors would go to the next country and they would share their projects. This is one of the projects that was shared, and it's one of my favorite because it's actually a conductive paint done with vitamin C, so it's edible. And the girl who created it, Sahar, shared this recipe, you can do it in your kitchen today, with the people in Kenya. So that was the next country in our journey of making. And here you can see the mentors coming from Egypt, training girls from Akili Dada community, which is a community trying to empower young African women to create their own jobs. And after these girls would learn, we would go together to schools. And we went to schools that had computers and were private and very rich, but we also went to schools like this one in the slums, in the slum of Madare. There are a million people living there. And the next part was to actually travel with the mentors from Kenya to Tanzania. This is a picture I took from my phone. This is Kilimanjaro. And this picture was taken after traveling in bus for 2 days, talking about team building. And these are the mentors from Kenya training the people in Tanzania. Marta is 18, and Brian is 19, and they're training a whole group of people in Tanzania. They're meeting with their neighbors for the first time and thinking, what can we do? What are the projects that would make a difference? How can we do them with the resources we have access to? And afterwards, the local mentors from Tanzania would go again to schools. And at some point, they asked me, like, Stefania, why do you want us to train kids? This is very complicated, even for us. How could a child learn how to build his own microscope from an old webcam? By the way, that's like, you can also do that today at home. And I told them, like, but it's very easy, and children are very, very smart, and you learn a lot from them. And they didn't believe me, and when we went to schools, they saw the children would ask questions they never thought of, and they would come up with ideas and designs that they never imagined. And they actually felt a bit embarrassed because the children would learn so much faster. So it's a bit contagious. Once you start doing that, you can't stop. And the journey continued on dusty roads to Rwanda. And here we actually realized that one of the big problems is that it's really hard to have access to certain parts, like Arduino. I don't know if you heard of it. It's a board that enables you to prototype with sensors, to do vertical gardening, to do anything you want. So the mentors in Rwanda thought, okay, we can't order it in Rwanda. No one trusts us to deliver things online here. So we're going to build it ourselves, and we're going to use old components from computers that are donated to us but are worthless. And we're going to take those chips and make our own board. And they made an Arduino board, which is only $2.50. It's like Lego pieces. And the journey continued after Rwanda to Zambia. We went to schools here as well, then Botswana, here, this is actually a training of mentors that we made in the dark at the University of Botswana. And this is one of the mentors that you will meet afterwards, Bokamoso. She actually came to the next part of the project as well. We went to Ghana, 40 degrees, no shade. Was really hard, did maker fairs in technology schools. It was very interesting because I thought that it was going to be very hard to get into universities and schools, and they would be a bit resistant to this kind of new methodology that is focused on the students, where we enable them to build what they want, they get to choose, it's personalized. But actually, all the schools were very open and willing to send their students to figure out what can they find locally in the local electronic shops. I love the name of this shop, the Home of Modern Electronics. And afterwards, these students that learned for the first time how to program 2 weeks before, they would go and train hundreds of students. They would make a maker fair inside the Ghana Technology Institute. All of these stories and the different projects were documented, and we really tried to make it simple. Like, we really tried to open up these kind of projects to everyone and lower the barrier of entry to science, technology, problem solving. And we're actually making a book about the whole project. It's going to be launched next month. And the next part of it was, okay, so how could we take this further? What will need to happen for these mentors, for these young makers, to be able to do this for a living? Because they still don't have all the skills they need, and they're caught in their routine life where they need to have jobs that they don't like, or they need to go to university, and it's not always very, very demanding, or it's not fulfilling for them. So we thought, what would happen if instead of 2 weeks, which was our training when we were in Africa, we would spend a whole month, and we will actually gather all these people together, and they will not only get the kit, which was the sensors and the box, but they will learn how to build a space. Because if you go in a village in a country where there's no maker culture, no prototyping culture, where do you start? So we gathered all these makers from all around the world. Our youngest participant was 14, Mark, from Berlin. Bokamoso from Botswana. We had a lot of mentors from Africa that couldn't join us in Berlin because of visa issues. That was very difficult. And we were thinking, like, what does making mean? What does prototyping mean? Like, these are examples of various maker spaces or spaces where people are crafting and prototyping from all around the world. You see a cooperative in Rwanda, you see Bell Labs in US, you see a space in Singapore, a space in New York. The way we perceive making and the makerspace movement and the way we're teaching our kids is really different around the world. So how could we combine that? So our idea was to use a shipping container, talking about the boat. And we actually thought about this because we have shipping containers all around the world. They're very affordable, they're modular, we can stack them. Plus, the space is small, and that's a great constraint because you need to be very smart with the way you're using it. And this is how it looked like in the first week. Not sexy. It smelled bad. Was rusty. And we had no tools and no materials, nothing. I told you we only had a month, so after the first week, this was supposed to be a fully functional invention lab, makerspace. So after the first week, we basically went on the streets, tried to find pallets, called all the different companies, tried to see if they could give us paint, tools, borrow. We went out of our way, and this was an amazing experience for the young participants because they were used to have all the tools bought for them and all the materials, and all of a sudden they were, you want us to build a space and we have nothing? How does that work? But actually, they managed to do it. After the first week, we prepared this whole installation. We built furniture, we built a space, we had an improvised rooftop, and we were ready to welcome our opening party. So at the opening party, it was very interesting because we actually tried to invite and involve the whole maker community in Berlin. We had more than 80 applications for activities, and we really tried to diversify, have juggling, stand-up comedy, drones, soldering, everything you can imagine, knitting, because the idea was really bring everyone around the table, enable people to become curious, to learn from each other, to see how they could combine what they're doing, to get to know people they would not get to know normally. So that was our opening party. It went very well. The makers were exhausted but very happy, our camp participants. And then we started the camp tracks. So the beauty of our camp is that they could get to choose what they wanted to learn more about. And we had 19 camp tracks, everything from creative coding to designing your PCB to learning how to run your own business to learning how to train kids. My favorite part was really the fact that they had to communicate with so many different people. Like, our container is right next to the Berlin Wall. So we would get so many tourists that would come in and it's like, what is this place? So every day we had like opening hours where they would explain what 3D printing is, what the containers is there for, what are their projects. And that really forced them to learn how to communicate with people from all around the world. And the big day of the camp was the demo day. And a lot of them have never presented in public before. Plus, they had to finish their projects. Like, they had to go from the initial prototype to the final project. This was one of the projects called Patricity, done by Ruby from Mexico. She designed like this smart toy. His name is Spike, it's a dog. So children could like play with their electronic pets and actually program them and change parts of them. The good thing about our camp is that we actually documented everything. So you can visit our container in 3D. All the furniture, all the dimensions, all the projects and the tracks that were done, everything is online. So if anyone else wants to do a similar camp someday, or they have to run a makerspace, they could just reuse all of those resources. And actually, I told you that there were a lot of people from Africa that couldn't join us because of visas. And I wanted to share one of the stories of our camp participants with you, to kind of understand that, yeah, there are a lot of pains of growth that we don't imagine, but this is why we don't see initiatives like this more often for now. So Bokamoso, Bokamoso means future in Botswana, in the local language. Bokamoso is 22, she's studying computer science in Gaborone, that's where I met her. We did workshops in schools. She's like the founder of the student society there. Very ambitious girl, very hardworking. So this is her in Berlin, the first time we convince her to wear a dress. And what was interesting with Bokamoso is that I was trying very hard to convince her local university to give her a fellowship because I thought it's important for them to support their youth, their talent, to learn and come back and share that knowledge. And initially they said they will cover her flight and send her with a fellowship. In the very last minute, they canceled that because they decided that it was important for her to not miss a semester from her university. But in the end, she came, and I wanted to show you a video, an interview with her at the end of the camp.
My name is Bokamoso Palai, and I'm from Botswana. My project at Maker Campus was an electricity monitor, which measures the amount of electricity consumption. Baking field, electronics, engineering field is not just for men. We also can do this. As you can see, I managed to create something that is very useful and very electronic. I had to learn to use a circuit and mechatronics. But I managed, even though I'm a female, and they all can do that, so they shouldn't be afraid of the fields.
Yeah, and I think this is a very... I think this is a very strong message, especially for the girls back home, because if they see her being able to do this, they would be less afraid to try. And I see this problem all the time. Last week, I worked with these girls in Berlin. They're like from Turkish and Arabic schools in the outskirts of Berlin, and they learn how to code for the first time in their life. And they were doing this map of the soil properties in Berlin, but it was absolutely fascinating to see, just like Bokamoso, how much they're enjoying it and how much they can contribute back to their community. Now they're teaching programming, they want to go and teach in their schools. And they were presenting in front of an audience of scientists from an Anthropocene project in Berlin. For the first time in their lives, they presented in front of 200 people a project they just built, and they demo it live. So I think if we start to do this at such an early age, later on, we could actually achieve this. I don't know if you've seen this picture. These are the Indian women engineers that last month managed to send the first Indian satellite to Mars. And the cost of that project, the budget for it, was less than the budget they used to make the movie Gravity. I wanted to show you that small can mean a lot. These are predictions calculated by General Electric and the World Bank. And sometimes, even if we change a little bit the things we are doing, it could have such a huge impact. I know there are a lot of conversations around the health problems in UK, and not only in UK, but we can also talk about energy, transportation, gas consumption. If we just reduce 1% of the things we're doing, it could have such a huge impact on the long term. And I think this 1% starts now, starts with us, starts with everything we can do, starts with everything we can build. But first of all, it starts with sharing and learning from each other. And I hope that we could make this together, that we could create a sort of gravitational force and build a future that our children will be proud of. Thank you very much.